we are at Port Fish today, which is in just a little bit north of Port Washington. And they have an aquaponic and hydroponic system that they run, unfortunately not for profit, but for the betterment of the world.
We consider ourselves a commercial operation, and we're constantly trying to figure out how to push plants through here. Let me go back to the beginning. We're Port Fish Limited. We're a non-profit. We've been doing the aquaponics for about 9 years. This is Model 3. Model 2 is in Port Washington, hanging off the back of our house. Model 1 was several aquariums in our back room in the house. And we have 6 southern exposure plant beds in the windows. And number 1 convinced us that aquaponics worked. Model number 2 showed us more about it. It demonstrated the participation of bacteria in the process. And after that, we decided that something like this would be appropriate, so we went with this about 5.5 years ago. Aquaponics, aqua water or green water or working water, and ponics, hydroponics. You all are looking at a hydroponic system right here. This is all hydroponic. Some of you have probably had an aquarium. Okay, most important thing with an aquarium is? Anyone?
Aerator.
Aerator filtration. Keep it clean. You know that. Keep the water clean. Well, in this system, the plants are the filter. They are the filter, and they're benefiting from the nitrates that are constantly feeding them. The plants absorb the nitrates via the root systems. They're suspended in these this insulation, just a standard insulation, and they're pulling out the nitrates. Pulling out the nitrates reduces the toxicity of the water. It goes back to the fish clean. So, similar to your aquarium, the cleanliness of the system is crucial. We feed the fish. We have white, we have yellow perch, and we'll see them in a minute. But we feed the fish, and they create two wastes, solids and ammonia. And the solids we manually pull out of the system, and we compost it. The ammonia passes through what we call biofilters. And the biofilters are just big barrels with sand in them. And the sand is the home of colonies of bacteria. Nitrosomonas converts the ammonia to nitrites, and nitrobacter bacteria converts the nitrites to nitrates. And the nitrates are plant food, right? And the plants absorb it, clean the water, goes back to the fish. So it's a, I like to consider it an ecosystem. This is an ecosystem, and maybe you all have seen some other aquaponics facilities advertised that look like factory farms or high-tech installations. I'm trying to figure out the difference between that kind of facility and this kind of facility. This is clearly an ecosystem where we have an interaction between a community of organisms with their environment. Here's our hardening table where we store our small ones waiting for spaces. In the winter time, we use these gutters, and the gutters are generally filled with little plants, and they get about this height before they find access to the system. So, is this cost effective? No, it is not. In our society, in our capitalist society, we have basically a bottom line. And the bottom line is an economic bottom line. Does it work or not? And if it doesn't work, it goes. If it works, we work it. In local food, we have to have three bottom lines: the economic, the social, and the environmental. And you look to the social and the environmental to support the economic. We're working like the Dickens, and I suppose we could work harder, but I'm still pulling money out of my pocket to make this work. But it's working the best now than it's ever worked, and there's prospects for it to get even better. And to get even better may mean we will get closer to breaking even. In terms of making a profit, not in my lifetime. I don't know. I say that because we have to keep our prices near the industrial food industry's prices, because unless we're serving an engaged population, and by engaged I mean that population wants to eat food, they know where it came from, and they will pay for that right. And they will do it 24/7, 365. The problem we have is we do get people who are interested, and they'll stay with us three or four rounds, but then they see their hand X for our lettuce, and they can get it for Y at the store, and they start going back to the store. Very nice, Jane. I like that segue. We will go from the hardening table into bin number two, where we start our process, and then we'll go look at the fish.
Okay.
We start the seeds here. We process our primary product, which is a salad blend. And the salad blend consists of two or three lettuces, baby greens, and microgreens. The baby greens would be sorrel, arugula, Swiss chard, a couple different kales. I said sorrel, watercress, and there might be one other. But we grow those baby greens out in number one, west side of the building. The microgreens are right here. We grow radish and sunflower. And you can see we have a tray with about a half an inch of non-soil, bark material and the vermiculite.
non-soil, and we just cover the surface with the sunflower seeds, keep them moist, and they'll pop open, and we're just using a standard T8 fluorescent light there, not a grow light. And once they start growing, we come up with something like this, and this is about 3 or 4 days away from being harvested. And our harvesting, we just take a pair of scissors and give them a haircut. They fall down, and then we separate the seeds, the shells, from the microgreens.
No, micro meaning the age of them?
The age of them. Micro meaning using just the seed as the source of whatever comes out of that seed. Micro versus baby, which would be a different plant that you grow to its full height or actually half its height. But you can do that with just about any seed. And the interesting thing about microgreens is that whatever benefit is in that plant, it's concentrated in the seed. So you're getting the most of that sunflower plant. Of course, the sunflower grows up to a much bigger thing, but the reality of the concentration is in that seed is here. And we don't attempt to grow this beyond what's in the seed. We keep it moist, and it'll grow up to a certain height. It's a non-soil material, and if we just kept it like that, it would grow up and then...
Do you use any fish emulsion or anything to
fertilize? Well, we'll take water out of the system.
Okay.
And we'll
okay.
spray it. So, rock wool, okay, and the little plugs breaks up, about 9 cents a plug. You put the seeds in there, you put them on the tray. And if you look closely, you can see, well, some of you can see as gardeners, the seeds have popped open, okay? And probably tomorrow or the next day, we'll take that and we'll put it underneath the lights. I was talking about before manufacturing these, we might be able to do it less expensive, but it's a little bit more of a challenge.
Can you reuse the rock wool?
No, it's toast.
Okay.
And it is not biodegradable either. I suppose it is biodegradable, but we don't have enough time.
Yeah.
Now, in Maine, there is an architect who has a patent on his house because his house has two exterior walls separated by about 12 to 18 inches.
Okay.
Why don't greenhouses in colder climates use the same thing? Because part of his agreement, if you want to own one of his homes, you have to sign an agreement. You will never install a furnace because you won't need one in the coldest part of Maine.
Well, that's a nice idea.
Expensive.
And it's an expensive idea. Part of our problem is I have some sunken costs in this building which I will never recover. Okay? They're gone. But it makes me happy that they're here. Okay? So I'm getting something out of it. As soon as you start to get high tech with this growing, the greenhouse, etc., it's just more money. And it's not commercially feasible at this point because of the national food industry with the low prices, the absence of an engaged population, and the cost that we have to incur to grow. It just doesn't make economic sense to put money into the system. We originally wanted to do geothermal, which would solve a lot of my problems. If I owned the land, I would know where my $25,000 was, okay? And that would give me a nice warm feeling, and we would be missing some of the costs. But I don't own the land, and economically, it doesn't make any sense.
Now, you said you're a nonprofit.
Yeah.
about crowdsourcing, where you actually get people to support your project.
It goes back to the definition of engaged people. There aren't enough people out there that are wanting to throw $1,000 or $10,000 at us. There just aren't. Now, maybe I haven't been talking to the right people. Maybe I should talk to you some more. But the fact is, we have been talking, and that engaged population just hasn't materialized. We do have support, and we're taking advantage of the support, but again, I'm still pulling money out of my pocket. And I'm okay with that. My wife and myself, I employ two gardeners part-time, and there are three people that help me harvest part-time. Everybody's part-time. And clearly, it's not about me. I only keep the place clean. The rest do a lot of the important stuff. You have two tanks in here, 350 gallon. In each tank, there's about 500 fish, 400 to 500 yellow perch. This tank right here has the smallest, about 3 inches to 4 inches. And the tank behind you has the largest fish, which are about 8 to 10 inches. And we'll be harvesting this tank next week.
And we will. How deep are they?
You can have any kind of fish in here you want. You could have a yellow, you could have goldfish, you could have koi, tilapia, any kind of fish. But the fish has to have some use as it grows. And goldfish, pretty much limited. Koi, we might be able to make some real money on. Tilapia is part of an international market, so growing tilapia doesn't make you special at all. It just lets you compete with the Chinese and the Thais, which is fine, but and we're not making any money on the fish. We at best we're breaking even. But we do sell our fish for $14 a pound. We know where they were grown.
It's not $14 for a fish, that's fillet?
Yeah, that's fillet. That's a pound of fillet.
Oh, okay, not
the whole
fish.
Not the whole fish. I wish. I wish. Model 1 told us that it works, and so they wanted to come by and see that it works. Our Model 2 told us that anybody can build a system. Okay, a clever person with some tenacity can build an aquaponic system. The Model 3, or the third issue with aquaponics, is who are you going to sell your output to? It works and you know you can build a system, so you're generating a lot of output, but who's going to pay for it? And that's the weak point in aquaponics. Back to that engaged population. I'll tell you how this works. We got water coming in, there's standpipes in the center, it overflows into the standpipes, and it works its way around to the two barrels right over there, which you can't see. There's baffles in the barrels, and as the suspended solids that come through the system hit the baffles, they drop to the bottom. And we physically pull the solids out and we put them in that white barrel. And they settle. We run the clear water back and we take the sludge outside. The water continues, and the two barrels on the, blue barrels on the wall there, have our sand, and they are the biofilters. And they have our colonies of bacteria. Now, there's bacteria everywhere. Right, and we have Nitrosomonas and Nitrobacter bacteria in here. Bacteria, microbes are everywhere. It is a fact of life. It is a good part of life. To be perfectly honest with you, we wouldn't be here without them. But those two bacteria are in those biofilters, and they are converting the ammonia to the nitrates. And
And there's no area in the system that you have absolutely clean water and full ammonia. It's just a constant process. When the bacteria eat the ammonia, it becomes nitrates. The plants absorb it, less toxicity for the fish. The best, if you want to become part of the engaged population supporting pork fish, the best way to get our greens is through the CSA. In terms of the farmer's market, selling lettuce in the summer is like selling ice cream. it just doesn't work. But as I talked about therapy, you know, it's all a balance. You know, I enjoy it.
Cool.
And I'm paying for it. And I see.
That's a hobby, right?
Well, it is not a hobby. It is not a hobby. We jump through the same hoops any nonprofit does for the Internal Revenue Service.
But obviously your wife is involved.
Yeah, we work together on it, and she's bought into it. She's engaged. And you know, the three bottom lines you have to take advantage of. Because if it's just about the money, you're not gonna do it. Truly. That's why I'm here, because I'm taking advantage of those two bottom lines.
Did it show?
Yeah, this reduces the probability of them getting out. I will have occasionally some jump onto the net.
Okay.
And the same outcome.
Well, when they get bigger, they don't have the same.
No, they jump too.
Wasn't that an interesting trip? I mean, it smells good, it feels good in there, and there's just so many different activities that go into raising not only the fish themselves, but also the plants. It's wonderful. We hope you enjoyed it. If you did, please give us a thumbs up. And if you have comments or questions, we'd love to hear from you. Please join our garden family and subscribe. We'd love to have you. Thank you.
Connect with us on YouTube.